Hello.
Thank you. He's grown in popularity quite a bit since then.
If you have great seats, can you move in close? Yeah, please.
I don't know if you guys heard me, like right there, is that a free seat?
It is?
Yeah.
Can you move in and close that?
Pull the fire alarms.
You have no.
This is what they do. Bomb threats and fire alarms.
If my argument is so stupid, then why can't you refute it? No. Shout them down. Motion.
I would.
our seats. I have a real side back in here from where I was sitting on my desk when I thought the power was going to go out. And I just looked at it today and I was like,
In case you haven't heard, Daddy smashed it in New Hampshire. Let him speak. Let him speak.
George Soros.
Soros. Don't worry about it.
I'll just say this, most speakers would have had you removed by now. I'm very happy for you to stay. If you've got something on mic. If you don't want to be here and you don't want to listen, leave. If you want to be here, go to mic. Would you please continue your questions, sir? I'm close to having these people in the room. Let's try to avoid that. Just you carry on.
I would like to learn how I can qualify for the Milo Yiannopoulos white privilege, or the privilege.
The government statistics in the UK demonstrate very clearly that the most educationally underprivileged group in Britain is poor white boys. In America, the situation is more complicated. There are problems with black education, deep-rooted problems. That's not something I felt that I was qualified to address. What I can do, however...
You guys know how to debate?
George Soros!
George Soros gave you $33 million!
Soros!
How does it feel to be funded by an old white man? Alright, what I felt I could help with was a group that here too is suffering. And I don't think we need to get into league tables of oppression like the left does, because it doesn't take us anywhere helpful. It's just a, you know, all we end up doing is yelling at each other, and we don't get anywhere. So what I identified was a group of people that were suffering, that were hurting, who were educationally underprivileged, and that I felt like I had some affinity to. Other people are perfectly willing to work in their own foundations if they wish to. If you know, the best thing you can do in this hall, if you don't agree with my privilege grant, is do well in life and open your own. Certainly, if you're a woman in the audience, you are a white, Western, middle-class woman. You're the most privileged group in the history of civilization. So, you should find no problem whatsoever in having a competitive advantage against men in the workplace. In fact, many of the statistics suggest that women under 40 earn more than men now for many jobs, and you have a competitive advantage going for those jobs. You should be able to do great in life and start your own foundation. So, if you don't like it, you can do your own. The privilege grant is a small thing. Now, for poor families, very often the difference between going to college and not going to college isn't $50,000. There are some loans available. Most schools don't ask for that kind of money up front. Very often the difference can be $5,000 or $10,000. And people will try to assemble that from various scholarships, loans, some are ability tested, some are means tested. I've established a scholarship fund that I think will help people, some people who need it. We have some wealthy donors who believe the same thing. We'll open applications later this year, and we will disperse scholarships for the next academic year, 16-17. It's $2,500. We're going to give 50 of the way to the first year, 100 in the second, and 200 in the third. So if you have, if you are looking to apply to college in the next 3 years, then you will be eligible. So look out for details, and we'll be happy to give you our money.
Okay, first, Your hair looks fantastic tonight. You're welcome.
Woo! Woo!
As a white middle class woman, I had to comment.
This is four bleaches. Like, I got so much.
Second,
this takes work. Don't do it.
Second, something that's not talked about or as often from you is in the PC culture is the trans movement and gender pronouns and that whole thing. And included in that is like that is a need for safe spaces. Is there the trans movement has no place to go? I was just wondering what your thoughts were on that topic.
Well, I wrote a column saying that the T should be ejected from LGBT. And the reason I think that is that most of the objectives of the modern transgender lobby are entirely entirely in conflict with what I think most gay and lesbian people want. Transgender lobby seems to be about policing language, about safe spaces and trigger warnings. It seems to be about heavily politicized posturing. It seems to be very anti-science. Seems to not really want to look at the studies, look at the data, look at anything that might suggest different treatment pathways were better for sufferers of this psychiatric disorder. And it seems to me entirely antithetical to all the good things about being gay, which are about liberation, experimentation, and pushing the boundaries of what's allowed. So the transgender people I know aren't particularly happy with their own lobby. They don't feel like they're being well represented by the non-trans journalists who never stop banging on about this, but don't even know very much about it. The dirty secret about this is nobody cares about it. This is an invention of the left because it's run out of things to complain about. It's won on gay marriage, it's won on all of the equality stuff, it's won on everything else. So it's reduced, as all movements are when they run out of things to complain about, to being ever more shrill about ever more irrelevant things. Nobody cares about people who are a bit mental and cut their cocks off. Nobody cares about them. But we're forced by the left to take a political position on this. It is demanded of us that we have the right opinion about it so that we're not considered bigots or hateful people. Well, it's a perfectly reasonable point of view, supported by much of the science, that transition surgery isn't the right treatment pathway for people with this disease, with this psychiatric disorder, classified as. It bears no relation to gays or lesbians. You know, one is a sexual orientation, and the other is a dysphoria, identity disorder. It's a perfectly reasonable point of view, supported by the science, that transition surgery isn't the right treatment pathway for these people, and they should have therapy and drugs instead. My personal view is that we're going to look back in 30 years, much like we did at electroshock therapy in the Victorian era for schizophrenics, and wonder how we could ever have been so barbarically cruel as to subject these people to these treatments. Now, that point of view would get you fired from any major newspaper. The reason I correctly suggest I don't talk about it very much is I don't think people care about it very much. It's just the left insists on taking political positions on these things. It's really not my fault. Coming back to Chuck.
So, my question for you as a UK citizen is, what is your opinion on the upcoming referendum for the UK to leave the European Union?
I don't think it serves Britain's interest to be in Europe anymore. It's very clear now the European project isn't about a common market, it's about super state. Now, some people think that's the only way that Europe can survive as an economic power, but I don't see why we should decline together rather than all declining separately. And in fact, Britain, if it broke away, is not necessarily destined to decline like the rest of Europe is. I think, you know, British, UK export markets are dramatically different as a result of the Commonwealth to the rest of Europe. Our values are different to the rest of Europe. Our currency, thank God, is still doing it doesn't make much sense to me for us to be a part of it anymore. So I hope British people vote to leave, but I don't think they will. Next question.
I was wondering your stance on what XKCD calls cytogenesis, where some author will post something defamatory about, let's say, you mm-hmm. or the Gamergate scandal, which you've been involved in, mm-hmm. and then Wikipedia will use those articles as sort of its base for constructing the article and only portray that one side, and then other articles will take over, read that Wikipedia article, and purport that one side without giving credence to the other side.
Right, the media is deliberately and systematically dishonest, and it knows that Wikipedia is populated by so sort of person with certain kind of politics. That's a very real phenomenon you're describing. It's certainly the case in the gay engaged controversy, and the case about many public figures who don't have popular points of view. There's not very much that can be done about it except read better journalists. There are better journalists out there, there aren't as many of us. But I think if you're getting your information about people from Wikipedia in 2015-16, you need your head tested. If you're a journalist doing it, you need to be fired. Next question.
Also, what
are
your...
I don't know. I thought I wanted to listen to
the videos. Do it!
Sorry, carry on.
What are your views on socialism?
Go off!
This guy can also be on socialism. Socialism's worked great, right? Everywhere it's been tried, it's resulted in glittering utopias of equality and happiness. I think if you vote Sanders in, you should be ready to leave the country. I'm very excited about Sanders Trump. Because you've basically got Daddy, who's awesome, versus this crazy old man.
The Muppet.
Is that what you call him?
Yeah, I call him that.
Well, he's like those men at the box, right? we'll skip over socialism. I think that's obvious. What was the first bit of the question? An anarcho-capitalist. I like the idea, and I think everybody likes the idea, but then I think they hit 18. it's a bit like feminism in that regard. I think I like the idea because I'm sort of constitutionally fairly libertarian, but I don't like the way they talk about the military. They're incredibly disrespectful of service personnel and very rude about the idea. They all wear pocket squares. All of them. There isn't an anarcho-capitalist who doesn't show up with some awful pocket square, some nasty cheap polyester bit of crap. I can't go along with hatred of military, and I can't go along with fashion that bad. So whatever they believe, I think I'm out. But however, I'm going to be going to Mexico in a couple of weeks to talk to them about feminism as an attack vector of big state progressivism. On that, they are right. And many of these groups are right about a lot. It's just that they sort of get pushed into the loony bucket because their views are outside the Overton window, outside that that sort of acceptable limits of speech and discourse bucket that the newspapers and broadcast news like to stick to. Some of those groups very unfairly get called lunatics. By and large, for the most part, the men's rights movement is right about almost everything and is unfairly characterized as misogynistic sort of hate group. By and large, it seems like anarcho-capitalists are fun and interesting, but I'm glad they're not in government.
Boo!
I'm sorry. You'll graduate one day.
Live in this victim chamber. My question is, if feminists claim that they're trying to empower women, why do they try to get attention by feeling sorry for themselves?
Well, feminism is no longer about empowering women because women have been empowered. Indeed, it's always been weird to me that feminism wants to step down to equality. Women have always held social and sexual power in most circumstances, in most situations. And why do men do the things they do? Men go to the moon and develop the internet and do all these wonderful and interesting things to get laid. why do any of us do anything? Why do I have such ridiculous hair? You know, we do these things to attract the attention of whoever we want to be in or whoever we want to be in us. in some cases, women. The Camille Paglia is great on this. She talks about the fact that women have always held most of the social and sexual power in most situations. And feminism, in claiming that it wants equality is weird because it sort of wants to step down to being like men, which is bizarre to me. What's clear, the modern feminist movement has become a sort of female chauvinism. It's become a sort of, it's a very thinly veiled misandry. And it's very unattractive, as I said earlier, women have identified this as why they're abandoning it. Feminism, actually, I think, is not dead. And I think, although it still holds great power in among politicians, great power in academia and the entertainment industry, I think the tide of public opinion has already shifted away from it. All right, I've been told to ask a question, so I'm going to pick up the participant. No, I'm not feeling it.
So you mentioned earlier that universities have no longer become a place to explore dangerous ideas, and it's just put your head down.
Can I tell you, your accent's really adorable, right? Where are you from?
Jersey.
Are you from here?
Yeah. Not here.
Are you from like South or something?
Jersey.
No, it's not.
What's up, this dick? How do we take what's attached itself to the left? How do we remove the left from that, take the regressive out of it, make it progressive again? Can we? Basically, how do we make the left great again?
It's the again that's the problem with
that. Oh, yeah.
No, I mean, look, the left has been responsible for some things that we all now probably grudge me over. Some, at least. Anyway. Well, yeah, I mean. I think that the left needs to take control of the rogue elements. The right's been pretty good at that. So you look at the Republican establishment, they're quite good at sort of cutting out things they don't like. The Tea Party, they'd be quite snooty about. Trump voters, they're appalling about. And on the right, I think that's gone a little too far. The Republican Party's in a bit of trouble. But the left has traditionally been a bit more monolithic and has tended not to criticize its most extreme members. I think what we need to do is to encourage the left to realize that feminism and this sort of resurgence of the Black Power movement and all of these various other sort of weird intersectional identity politics-based innovations that have come about in the last 5-10 years are not going to win the elections because ordinary people don't like them. And I think the way to do that is to shine light on the weird excesses of the far left and using facts and humor. Nobody can resist the truth wrapped in a good joke. And that is always the best way to win an argument, is to tell the truth and it's funny. And the other thing I would say is after you leave university, increasingly we're coming into a period, I think, 2016 is going to be the year social justice effectively dies. Absurd language policing, the ridiculous gender and race politics, the craziness with trannies. I think all of that stuff is now beginning to reach the public. I think it's beginning to reach voters, and I don't think they like the sound of much of it. So 2016 is the year social justice, I think, is going to get a good kick in the teeth everywhere there are elections, and hopefully in the media too. When you graduate, after you've got your degree and put your head down from your old people's social justice, when you graduate, I think the smart thing to do is to start to gently and with good humour and intellectual humility to gently resist things when you hear them in life that is quite obviously not true and said to say somebody's feelings. Benjamin Shapiro likes to say that facts don't care about your feelings. Well, I find his approach sometimes abrasive, which is precisely why he does it and he likes that. My approach is a little different to Ben's. I prefer to disarm people with self-deprecating humor. I prefer to laugh at myself before I laugh at others. And I prefer then to just drill down and stick to a basic set of facts that tell me a little bit more about the world around me. The way to combat progressivism and the way to make the left great again is to make the most extreme elements, is to force the most extreme elements on the left to retreat into the obscurity and ridicule they deserve. The way to do that is to gently, insistently, with politeness, and with firmness and with good humour, remind them that the world they describe doesn't exist.
Yeah! 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 Yeah!
But just so you guys know, no matter who's the liberal Trotsky manager, he's a conventional misfit who is one of